Sky at the moment is crisscrossed with about 20 searchlights. It's the most magnificent sight. This plane is held in the lights, absolutely dead above us.
My husband flew 205 combat missions.
You hear those light ACAC guns?
Well, his name was Marion John Wood, but everyone called him Woody. And he was quite well known because I believe the Japanese in the mornings used to say, "Well, Woody, what are you doing today?"
Well, there go places from some of the...
And several of the boys told me that if they could fly on my husband's wing, they knew they'd get back.
But it means that our fighter is well on his tail.
Hello and welcome to Verbatim. I'm Jacqueline Arias. Today we hear from Gladys, a stunning and glamorous Sydney model who fell in love with and married a legendary American fighter pilot during World War II. And she wasn't alone. Just like Gladys, thousands of Australian women were swept off their feet by servicemen from the United States who caused both excitement and resentment while they were stationed here. The women they charmed were derided as Liberty Belles or Victory Girls, but that didn't bother Gladys in a heady time of love and work and war.
I'm Gladys Ward. I lived and grew up in Goulburn. Oh, I had been here for many times on visits, but I actually came to Sydney when I was 18 to go nursing. But I really decided that I didn't think it was my future. I really wanted to go into fashion. It was by chance that I was sent to Australia Silk Knit, and I met Irving Nyman there. He was the designer, had just come from the United States. And he just said to me, "Oh, Gladys, do you have a job?" And I said, "No." He said, "Well, I'm opening in a couple of days, so you better come and start with me." So that's how I became a part of the Sports du Jour.
Was that a big brand, that big label in those days?
Well, I think it was one of the few labels. It was considered very, very good. All the big stores bought lots of our swimsuits. I modelled a two-piece swimsuit, and it was a leopard skin, Lastex. I have an idea it came from the United States, but it wasn't received very well. I think they thought I was rather brazen, I suppose. It was a bit ridiculous because the trunks came right up to the waistline, but then they were not around the day I wore a rubber one at Manly, and I lost it completely in the surf. It was a sample that we were testing to see what was the possibility of a rubber swimsuit.
And so the possibilities weren't very good.
No, there wasn't a possibility. I'm not even sure that they retrieved the swimsuit. I think it went out to sea. I think the day I met my husband, it was a Friday night, and it was only by chance because I was supposed to meet someone else, and his friend was there waiting to tell me that unfortunately he had to go straight through to Melbourne and couldn't wait in Sydney. And he said, "I have met a couple of Americans here. They've just come in today." He said, would you mind if I introduce them to you?" And that's how I met my husband.
When a boy from Alabama meets a girl from Gundagai, winter turns into spring and the birds start to sing a sweet lullaby.
After Pearl Harbor, he had set off for the Philippines, but on the way they were told to divert because the Philippines fell. And then they went to Borneo, and that was much in the same state. And that is when they came down to Australia.
One long burst. Now, here with me at the moment is a pilot of a P-39 who's been taking part in engagements around here. Here, Jimmy, just a minute. Wouldn't that be a pretty good job to get up there to intercept that plane?
Well, that'd be swell. Good target practice.
And what did you think of that then?
It was good shooting.
The Air Force part of it was transferred to Sydney here. He usually stayed at the Hotel Australia. It was beautiful. You know, from Martin Place, there is a bank building, and then there was the narrow Rose Street, which was, at that time, a fashion street. You had the most beautiful stores there, the most beautiful garments and everything, and the Hotel Australia was at the top there. But it was the most beautiful hotel. It has the most magnificent staircase. And opposite the Hotel Australia was the a very beautiful theatre. I think when I came back in the United States and found that the Hotel Australia wasn't anymore, I just couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it.
That believe it or not, he sure likes her a lot. A silver lining's in the sky. Pretty soon they're strolling out together. A new day has begun.
When he was on leave, well, he would only have maybe 10 days, and it wasn't so difficult to organise your social life for 10 days. So, no, we went everywhere. We went to all the theatres. We were out all the time. And we went to Romano's, we went to Prince's. So we went to nightclubs. You danced. Yes, we danced.
Meets a girl from Gundagai. The storm clouds disappear. Instead, a rainbow's in the sky. When a boy from Alabama tells the girl, say you're a honey, then the dinkum.
He spent quite a lot of time at the apartment, but I think they were the first service apartments. We had a lot, a variety of people living there. We had correspondents, newspaper correspondents from overseas, diplomatic people from who had been in Europe. But then we had a very splendid restaurant down below, the Normandy restaurant. It was a Hungarian. And in our service apartment, we had the intercom that we could call through and have a meal sent up.
Was there a lot of shortage of food, and was there a lot of shortage of things?
I don't remember shortage of food. Some things were rationed. Oh, I suppose a lot of things were rationed, but I think we had enough.
When I spoke to you on this day a year ago, it was apparent to us all that 1942 was going to be the most critical and anxious year which Australia had ever experienced. And we scarcely dared to contemplate what the position of Australia might be before the year came to an end.
And there used to be a very social place up on at the Domain, and it was only a stall of hot dogs. But you know, it was amazing. At maybe 2 o'clock in the morning, after you'd been to a ball, so many, we drove there and we had hot dogs.
Whether we should still enjoy the freedom we had enjoyed in the past, or whether we should find ourselves under the yoke of an alien and a savage race.
My husband was quite a good, he had a lot of rhythm, and he was loved music.
And finally, Wally and the Boys conclude their musical mimicry with an impression of Wally and the Boys.
No, I wouldn't say he wasn't one of the jitterbugs. A lot of the GIs here, well, they were very good, weren't they? They used to swing them up and down between the legs and all over the place. No, I never belonged to that. I never ever saw that. I never saw it being done. The only thing was a waltzing. I used to like waltzing. The rest of it, no, we used to do the rumba. But that's very dignified. We were married at in St. Mary's Cathedral at, I think it was 6:30 at night, and it was a blackout, and we walked. We just walked across the park for our wedding, and we walked back again to the reception. Well, it was a blackout, so it wasn't necessary to have a car anyway.
Didn't it feel odd, though, that here you are in the middle of a city with a blackout because there's a possibility that you may get bombed, and here you are walking across the park getting married?
No, I don't think that thought ever entered our heads. Someone said to me there was a lot of hostility against the Americans. And I said, I think I said at the time, well, I cannot see why that was necessary, because if it hadn't been for the Americans, maybe we wouldn't be here anyway. And another thing, they did bring money into the city. And I think a lot of girls had a lot of dates that maybe they wouldn't have had.
In fact, there was a great deal of hostility towards the Americans. They were a great attraction to Australian women. The Americans were better paid, and they could afford the more expensive nightclubs, restaurants, and silk stockings, a very coveted fashion item during the war years. The Australian servicemen, on the other hand, were considered to be lacking charm, money, and sophistication, and they were still wearing uniforms based on the style of World War I. By contrast, the Americans looked like they'd come straight out of a Hollywood film.
It did hurt, I think, quite a lot of, well, not a lot, but some young men were very hurt. Also, you see, the Americans had more money than the Australians. And I think they felt that in that way the Americans were superior, not only superior in De Niro.
When a boy from Alabama tells the girl, say you're a honey, then the dinkamazi girlie doesn't care he's got no money. He phones her in the morning and makes a special date. She hurries home from work that night. To see him, she can't wait. He looks like Robert Taylor. She loves his manly walk. She reckons she could sit for hours and listen to him talk.
I just don't know how to say about it, because I just took it for granted. I went to a lot of parties. We had a great time. We went everywhere and did everything. And you knew that in 10 days' time you'd be going out to the airfield for them to go back.
It's only just a very, very faint speck in the searchlights now, and he's heading out well towards the west of the town. But now he's gone well clear, way out behind the hills.
It was funny, and yet when came on leave, we were not morose or downhearted. I mean, when my husband went back, maybe I went back to my apartment in that evening, and perhaps the son of my neighbour was leaving for overseas. And you know, a lot of them went into Singapore, and all they did was land and go on the Kokoda Trail. I know so many who died like that. So I was lucky in a way.
Searchlights are holding it absolutely perfectly in their beams from all sides. And at the moment I can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
We have lost many gallant men. Many valuable ships have been sent to the bottom of the sea. Submarines have attacked our harbours. Some shells and bombs.
Did he ever talk to you about his missions and what he did out there?
No, he didn't. He didn't talk about it at all. Never. Never, never, never. And I think if you've flown 205 combat missions, I think you must get a bit tired of wondering whether I'll come back today or not. He played bridge a lot. He was a very good bridge player. But then all it's funny, all flyers that I've met have been good bridge players because they spent a lot of time waiting to go out, I suppose.
Did you ever ask any questions?
No, I don't think I did. I think I felt that if... I probably felt if you didn't want to talk about it, well, why bring it up? Because... how do you talk about it anyway? Do you know, as I talk about it, many, many things come crowding in, but they aren't things that you... I don't think you want to talk about them, really.
What about the women that you were surrounded with, and women who also had their husbands or brothers...
They had sons and...
sons, etc., going off to war. What was the morale? How did you all keep... your spirits up?
I don't think I dwelt on it. Maybe I did occasionally, but there was too much going on all the time because, you see, there was movement all the time of people going here and going there and some coming back, and so you just didn't have time, I think. But you were not going out on the town, as you might say, but you would go out to dinner. There were always young men you'd known, even grown up with, who would be turning up, and, well, you made the most, you just went out with them. And I think in that way I think you helped both of you in a way.
And I seem to find the happiness I see when we're out together dancing cheek to cheek.
What did you do when he went away on his missions here in Sydney? What were you left to do?
That's one thing about it. If you were down here, you didn't know. You didn't know whether he was on a mission or not.
And what did you do during the time he was away?
Well, I was working. Oh, my dear, I worked all the time.
And that was the sports du jour. You were selling, and you were also...
I was selling and buying accessories. I used to buy threads and buttons and... fancy bits and new pieces of fabrics that came in. In fact, I saw the first piece of Velcro. You know the Velcro that on everything now? I saw the first piece of that and I said, I think you should try some of this because it'd be marvellous. And they did. They bought some of it, but do you know what? We couldn't sell them. No one wanted it. It was too new, I think. It was too new.
The splendid resistance of the gallant Dutch together give us a feeling of both sadness and pride. Japan has moved one step further in her speedy march south. But the fight of the Dutch and the Indonese in Java has shown that a brave, freedom-loving people are more than a match for the yellow aggressor, given even a shade below equality in striking and fighting weapons. But facts are stern things.
What happened when the Japanese... submarines were in the harbour.
We knew they were along the coast somewhere, and there was a blackout. It was quite a tragedy, really, because they came in and they hit a training ship. They hit a Sydney ferry that had been turned into a training ship, and they lost. I think they lost quite a few young lives there. But you know, it was strange because people left the seafronts and went inland. Crowds of them, you know. You could have bought property. You could have bought property for a song because everyone was going inland.
We, the Allied nations, were unready. Japan, behind her wall of secrecy, had prepared for war on a scale of which neither we nor you had knowledge. We have all made mistakes.
And we thought when the siren went, we'd better run because Woody had gone back to... he went back to Bankstown because that's where his plane was. And the commanding officer of his squadron out there, he took up his plane and he crashed it on the bridge. He killed himself. And we went down into the cellars of number 7. And we stayed there until the all clear.
And I was on the dance floor when suddenly somebody came to the door and shouted, "Air raid, the firing again." By that time, the music had stopped. Somebody had told the band, and everybody was informed. The air raid was on.
The plane at the moment is absolutely dead above me. It's flying almost dead under the light of the moon. Someone is optimistically firing with a light machine gun behind us there, but it's well out of its range.
Early in 43, the American embassy advised me that I could join my husband in Charters Towers, and he was going. He would be going, coming down from New Guinea to train oars and supervise new pilots coming in from the United States. Yes, I went to Charters Towers. I went to Brisbane and then to Townsville and across by train to Charters Towers. It was only a short time, a short trip, I think, about 100 miles in those days, but it took practically all day. And in Charters Towers, he was training them as they came in. He was flying a lot. And then in the evenings, we usually went out to the post and played 7-up or gambled a bit. My husband went back to the States in 43, but then I came back to Sydney, and I waited. My husband had gone. The embassy, yes, the American embassy got me a passage on a Swedish ship from Melbourne.
Was that a scary thing for you to do, knowing that there is a war still on, and here you are about to go on a trip on a boat across the Pacific?
No, I didn't think about it. No, I didn't think about it at all.
On the great waters of the Pacific Ocean, war now breathes its bloody steam. From the skies of the Pacific pours down a deathly hail. In the countless islands of the Pacific, the tide of war flows madly. For you in America, for us in Australia, it is flowing badly.
Well, there could have been problems, but I was travelling on a Swedish ship, which was neutral. I just thought I was lucky to get a passage during the war, because not many people were able to travel at all.
What happened, and what sort of people did you meet? What did you do for a whole month on a boat?
I don't know. I think we played music, we played cards, we just were lazy, I think. Just lazed around, that was all. Didn't do anything much. But we never saw any enemy action or anything like that. And we went up the coast of South America and then North America and up to New York. I guess I might be about the only person who ever went into the United States and didn't show their passport. But I had bought new luggage in Vancouver, and I had locked my passport in a piece of it, and oh, it was such nice luggage. And when the custom, maybe I shouldn't talk about this, when the custom or the person came around to inspect one's passport and everything, I couldn't find the key to my suitcase. So I said to the officer, "Oh, but you wouldn't break it just for a passport, would you?" And he was very, very nice. And he said, "No, we won't do that." And he gave me the address. And he said, "When you get to New York, post back your passport," which I did. And they stamped it and posted it back to me.
In It was rare for a woman or any civilian to travel during the war years. But once the conflict ended, 15,000 Australian brides made the long journey across the ocean to the United States on converted battleships, with high hopes for love and marriage.
You know, when you start to think about it, you begin to wonder, don't you? It's almost as though it didn't happen. We were married, what, 53 years? It's a long time.
Thank you to Gladys Wood for sharing her story. Thank you also to ABC Radio Archives. Technical production by Judy Rapley, and I'm Jacqueline Arias. Join us next week for another Verbatim here on ABC Radio National.